And we're almost done with them. Hey, Larry Brown. How you doing, sir? Thank you for tuning in. Hey, Sacramento, how's everybody doing? It is Wednesday, and you're listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. I am Agent Key, and of course, we are selling Sacramento. Today's topic, atonement, understanding the need for reparations. And some may ask, why are we having this topic on this show about real estate? I am a firm believer that one of the main reasons why Blacks, African Americans, are at the bottom of the totem pole on the majority of charts and graphs where things are positive, and on the top in charts where and graphs where things are negative, is due to things that we will discuss on our show today. When we think about real estate and the percentage of home ownership, Blacks' percentage of home ownership in the United States, that is another chart where we are on the bottom. We cannot tackle increasing the number of Blacks and home ownership, which, by the way, is the fastest building wealth tool, real estate. We can't address that issue without addressing the topic that we'll be discussing today. Atonement. What is atonement? Atonement is the concept of a person taking action to correct previous wrongdoing on their part, either through direct action to undo the consequences of that act, equivalent action to do good for others, or some other expression of feelings or remorse. I'm going to share with you a few instances in which America admitted to acting wrongly and then made atonement for those wrongdoings. The Holocaust. The closest analog to reparations for slavery and Jim Crow is probably the reparations that West Germany agreed to pay after the Holocaust. A major component was the $7 billion West Germany agreed to give to the then young state of Israel. By the end of 1961, these reparation vessels constituted 2/3 of the Israeli merchant fleet. From 1953 to 1963, the reparations money funded about 1/3 of the total investment in Israel's electrical system, which tripled its capacity, and nearly half the total investment in railways. Israel's GNP tripled during the 12 years of the agreement. The Bank of Israel attributed 15% of this growth, along with 45,000 jobs, to investments made with reparation money. But that was actually a tiny fraction of Germany's total reparations payments, which totaled nearly $89 billion as of 2012, and largely went to individual survivors. The terms of the reparations, most of which are negotiated by the Conference on Jewish Material Claims Against Germany, which negotiated about $70 billion of the total, are constantly evolving, with some payments made on a one-time basis and others as monthly pensions of varying amounts. I mentioned Germany before jumping into America because that is probably one of the most significant events throughout the history of our present-day world that the majority of us can relate to because it's within our reachable lifetimes, on the same level as African-American slavery. So what has exactly the US done that they have made reparations for or atonement? Japanese Americans, during World War II, the US had its own concentration camps. Mm-hmm. Starting in February 19, 1942, by executive order of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, 125,000 people of Japanese descent were interned due to the unfounded suspicion that they would conspire against the U.S., and many of them were U.S. citizens, but were nevertheless forced to relocate from their West Coast homes to inland camps. The estimated losses for the community were estimated to be several billion dollars, both in lost productivity and property income losses. In 1948, Congress issued a reparation fund of $38 million. In 1948, the United States Congress issued a reparation fund of $38 million and then awarded each survivor $20,000 in 1990. About 80,000 people claimed the reparations for a total of about $1.6 billion. This is in our lifetime. The US and Alaska, the Japanese weren't the only ones who were displaced during World War II. While it was fighting against the Japanese, the US occupied the islands of Kiska and Attu in the Alaska and Aleutian chain and deported 881 Aleuts, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, forgive me if I'm not, to camps in Juneau, Alaska, about 2,000 miles from the island. In 1988, about 450 living survivors of the camps were awarded $12,000 each. I'm going to highlight these because I want you all to know and understand that as you're hearing reparations for African Americans, atonement and reparations for wrongdoings is not new. Get that understanding. North Carolina to eugenics victims. So what is this? In 2013, North Carolina became the first state to pay reparations to victims of forced sterilization and eugenic programs through a $10 million agreement. This is happening, what's happening right here in the United States. These are programs aimed at preventing people from reproducing who were incarcerated or who were to believe to have been, who have had physical and mental deficiencies, believed to have physical and mental deficiencies. And it was common in most US states from the early 1900s. In 2015, that is not even less than 10 years ago, Virginia, too, started a compensation program for victims of eugenic sterilization. How about the Tuskegee experiment? We're all pretty familiar with that. In 1932, the U.S. government left 399 Black men with syphilis untreated in order to study the development of the disease. The study was called the Tuskegee Study of Untreated Syphilis in the Negro Male. And it went on for 40 years. Overall, it involved 600 Black men. 201 of them were the control group, and the rest had syphilis. They were not offered treatment, even after successful cures had been widely adopted. And it wasn't until after an Associated Press expose that the study was closed. The victims filed a class action lawsuit settling for $10 million worth of reparations for the survivors, their widows, and their offspring. In 1995, a guarantee of free lifetime medical care for the victims, their children, and spouses was added to the reparation sum. So this goes on and on. There's actually three or four more that I could share with you. But for the sake of time, I just wanted to get those out to preface the conversation today. So on today's show, I have with me two individuals who are beyond knee-deep in this topic. I admire and respect them for the work that they're doing, for the progress that they've made, and I appreciate them being on the show today. And so I'd like to welcome our guests, Kim Mims and Chris Lodgson. And I want to introduce them, give you some information, some background about them, let them say hello, and then we're going to take a break, come back, and dive right into the discussion. So Kim is a first-generation Sacramentan with parents originally from Louisiana. She holds an associate's degree in television production and a bachelor's degree in communications. And she's had positions as a local film supporter and enthusiast. She's been an active liaison for the Sacramento International Film Festival and as a short film producer for Sac Fashion Week, and as an avid grant writer, political advocate, and astute project manager, Kim was instrumental in mobilizing efforts behind the creation of Sacramento's newly city-sanctioned film office, the historic passage of AB 3121, the California Task Force to study and develop reparation proposals for African Americans. Ms. Kim, welcome to the show today.
Hi, Keith. Thanks for having me. Thank you so much. And thank you for going over my bio there. As you can see right up at the top, I talk about, you know, my family's migration from Louisiana, which is very important when tying to lineage. So that's very important in what we're doing here. And then my love of film. I mentioned the film office that I was instrumental in, you know, helping get that started. But what happened with that is I did not even get a chance to interview for the position once they opened it up. So that really just showed me how deep the systemic, you know, systems run in city government. So
right.
That's why, you know, I fight for reparations.
God had other plans for you. So he didn't want to get you caught up in that. We needed you here doing what you're doing right now.
I absolutely feel that. I absolutely feel that way.
And next we have on the show, Mr. Chris Lodgson. And Chris is originally from New York City. He's now here in California. He is a legal researcher, a writer, entrepreneur, nonprofit leader, organizer, activist, and advocate for Black businesses, as well as reparative justice. He has organized both independently and with community-based organizations, as well as national nonprofit organizations for over 10 years on both the East Coast and the West Coast. Chris has helped found nonprofits supporting Sacramento Black-owned businesses, including Maximum Reach for Economic Equity, where he serves as president. He's also the creator and owner of Sac Black Business, Sacramento's largest and most active database and marketplace for Sacramento's Black businesses. Chris is the former chair of the Racial and Social Justice Committee at Organize When Legislate Sacramento, as well as former communications director for the California Young Democrats Black Caucus. Chris is doing quite a bit. His credentials go on and on and on. I want to point out though that Chris is also a staff writer and editor at the Elk Grove Tribune, where he writes on issues including local businesses, politics, and government. And he's a local advocate for Black American descendants of US slavery in the capacity as one of the founders of ARCC, which is American Redress Coalition of California. Chris and Kim both, I wanna make sure I got this right. Let's see here. So I think I advertised that both of you are founders of the reparations organization, the reparations organization. The name is not in front of me. Correct me if I'm wrong.
No worries at all. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So we are both And we have both, along with many, many, many other amazing people here in California, all across California, we have been very pivotal in helping get the California Reparations Task Force into law.
Okay. And that's AB 3121.
The Coalition for Just and Equitable California as well.
There it is. Okay. So the two of you are working side by side in this. It's amazing how paths can start off so separate and then come together to join forces. And I, with the history that both of you have separately in your bios, to bring that together, I see how you've been, and you've been doing this for years. And sometimes we don't see all of the hard work. We only see the reward of, you know, the result of your work. And so that's kind of where we are right now, Chris, with AB 3121.
That's exactly where we are. And I want to give you a shout out, Key, by the way, too. I know you just read my bio, which, you know, was too long, by the way. And you know, and obviously big shout out to Kim as well. But I really want to give you a shout out, Key, for one, laying that context as you open the show, right? And talking about how reparations is, and atonement is not something that's uncommon, right?
Right.
And one of our jobs over the next weeks, months, years, right, as people who are fighting for reparations, is to make sure that we normalize this conversation first among our own people.
Right.
Right. And then we got to take it outside to people who may not be our people, but that's one of our jobs over the next, you know, foreseeable future. So I do want to give you a shout out for laying that context. And yes, that's exactly where we are with respect to AB 3121, or as we call it, the California Task Force to Study and Develop Reparations Proposals for African Americans, with special consideration, obviously, for African Americans who descend from persons enslaved in the United States by these United States, right? Mm-hmm. And that's where we are. And you're absolutely right. You don't always see the hundreds of organizing meetings, the one-on-one phone calls, the meetings with legislators, the community meetings, the outreach we do, but you see the results of that, and we're super happy with that, because we're really working for the good of Black folks, not for ourselves.
Well, we're going to take a break, Chris, but when we come back, I want you guys to jump right into where this, how this started, where you are, and where it's going. And I know you're going to give us a nice history lesson. And it's important for us to know, we know that saying, you got to know where you've been in order to know where you're going. And I would love for you guys to jump right into that when we come back from the break. You're listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. I am Agent Key, and we'll be right back. Okay, I did not plug up this microphone. I want to make sure we get Chris over there. So I think for the people that are listening online. Yeah. Because that microphone is helping for people listening to the radio.
Right.
So this one is going to help pull him in for people who are listening online, That are radio deprived. Well, they would probably say that they were trendy.
That what they call it?
They're trending. Mm-hmm. So, Chris.
Hey, yes.
So, when we come back from the break, let me see here. I'm thinking of the best way to, we'll have about 20 minutes.
Yeah, they're about.
Before we need to take another break?
18, 20, somewhere in there.
Somewhere around there. Okay. So what I want to do is let you guys know how much time you're working with, but I want you to be able to get in the talking points. So one of the things that we talked about was, let's see. So you want to talk about the reconstruction years?
With the atonement, why don't we pick up there? And I want to make a point, and you know, it's a perfect segue about reconstruction,
yeah,
which was the first attempt at atonement.
Okay, yeah. Right? So let's pick up right there. And then Kim, as Chris is talking, if you want to jump in, I want you guys to use this as an opportunity to educate. And I only want to ask
questions, if as I'm listening, I hear a question that might be a natural one. But otherwise, I want you guys to do all the talking. Okay. Are you good with that too, Kim? Okay. Oh, you're muted. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. So when we come back, you guys will just kind of play tennis.
Let's do it.
Okay. Cool. She said yes. She is
I was trying to think of the tennis word. What is it? Love?
Yeah.
I haven't watched a lot of tennis, but we got you.
You are a consummate producer because every time you're not talking, you put yourself on mute. That's so I appreciate that. Let's see here. Were we able to get the commercial?
Okay.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
When?
It just went off.
The immense commercial?
Yes, ma'am. The one that used to woman to bring?
Yeah.
Yeah, it just went off.
I'm going to trust you. I was talking.
I know.
Okay, guys, we're coming back.
I'm actually going to double it so you had your whole minute break. You go two, one.
Hey everyone, we're back. You're listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. I am Agent Key, and on today's show, we are talking about atonement and understanding the need for reparations. And I have with us Kim Mims and Chris Lodgson, and they are going to educate us today on the background of why we are at this phase of coming to reparations are coming. As they are coming, there are a lot of questions that people have naturally. And a lot of it is just wrapped around the fact that we don't have the history. We weren't taught the history in the manner in which it should have been taught, let me put it like that. And when we were taught the little bit of history that we were taught, we weren't really wrapping our minds around it. It was served to us in a way where we just kind of accepted it to be a truth that we just walked with and didn't bother fussing about. But we are now some way woke folk. And so I am appreciative that we have both Chris and Kim on the show today. And Chris is going to pick up in talking about and educating us about the Reconstruction years, as it's very pertinent and crucial and pivotal. It was a pivotal point for us, and it was the U.S.'s first attempt. Chris, why don't you expound on that a little bit more?
Yeah, no, thanks, Key. And again, this is about, and this is picking up right where you left off in terms of the context that you were laying, where you started out talking about, you know, this example of reparations, this example of atonement for this group, for that group, right? Mm-hmm. And you really just hit the nail on the head too, just a second ago, as you were making a point, and I don't know if you knew what you were doing, but maybe you did, which is you were talking about history, right? And the telling of history, mm-hmm. right? And how that's done. To be honest with you, one of the things that happened right after the Civil War, and this is a very important time that we sometimes skip over, right? We don't really talk about this 7-10 years right after the Civil War, but this was a super, super important time. And one of the things that happened during this time is there was a huge backlash to any attempts to bring Black folks, formerly enslaved Black folks, into the American economy, into the American political system. There was a huge backlash. If you remember back in, you know, right after the Civil War, right, we had Field Order 15, mm-hmm. right? We had the 40 acres and the mule, right? That promise, right? We had Black folks actually start getting land, mm-hmm. right? And then we had huge backlash from white folks from the top down, from the president all the way down. We had the land that Black folks started to get be taken back. We had
Field Order 15.
Right. We had land that was confiscated from traitorous, you know, Confederates returned to them, mm-hmm. right? We had payouts and reparations to actually white folks, right, who lost their property, i.e. me and you, right? This time, and we had a attempt or tribe that actually succeeded in retelling the history and retelling the story of what happened during the Civil War, before the Civil War, and also what happened as years went by. So this is a very important time. And the reason why, I definitely want Kim to jump in here and talk about this too. But the reason why this is a very important time is because it was the first attempt at a reparations program, and it was a huge failure, particularly because of the white backlash. And we haven't seen any real movement toward reparations since then, except for and up until the work of folks like Kim and myself and people at ARCC and CJEC everywhere, all across the state, and then also all across the country too. There has been a resurgence over the last, couple years of the importance and the need for reparations. And that's because of the work of organizers on the ground, activists on the ground. And just, in the last 2 or 3 weeks, really, we've moved further, to be honest with you, further toward reparations than any time since that period of Reconstruction. Right. Kim?
No, you're absolutely right. And really, the political advocacy is key, because when you think about the time of Reconstruction, a lot of the lawmakers and politicians were Black. So it was a coordinated effort to get us out of politics, to suppress our vote, to take our land, and just to completely subjugate our race. And so, how do you fight against that? And what you were saying, Key, about, just not knowing the history, not learning the history, how it's supposed to be, that is true. But also the generation before us, I'm Generation X, I like to say Malcolm X, because we in here. But the boomers, they just wanted to get away from Jim Crow. They wanted to move on. They wanted to not be seen as lesser than. And they just wanted to receive the integration that was promised through civil rights. But we can see now that we're in 2021, that just has not happened. So right. Political advocacy is key.
And just to give some background on when we're talking about the Reconstruction Act, the Reconstruction Acts of 1867 laid out the process for readmitting Southern states into the Union. The 14th Amendment of 1868 provided former slaves with national citizenship, and the 15th Amendment of 1870 granted Black men the right to vote. Now, we can safely say that just because something becomes law doesn't mean that everybody gets on board with it. This is an era in history. That was 1867. That's over 200 years ago. But would you both say that we are still experiencing the impact of slavery 2021?
2021 and 2020, 2019, right? The major impact measure that we look at most closely, and there's a lot of different ways to measure what is the impact of the past on the present, right? For Black folks in particular, but the major measure that we use in our reparations work is what we call the racial or the lineage wealth gap, right? So we're talking about wealth, and you talk a lot about wealth here on your show, Key, Southern Sacramento. You talk a lot about generational wealth building, right, through housing and real estate. We're talking wealth, specifically the difference between what you own and what you owe, expressed as a dollar value,
right?
And the gap that we're talking about is the difference between the typical or average wealth position or wealth of a Black household versus a non-Black household, right? And wealth is important, and I don't know if everybody knows the data about wealth, but I know a lot of people know that Black folks don't have a lot of wealth, right? And that's true, and that's what the data tells you, basically. If you look at Well, though, in a more focused way, it's really one of the best ways to figure out what is the impact of the past on the present. For our case, what is the impact right now of 246 years of slavery, another 146 years of Jim Crow or Jane Crow, you know, as Dr. Cornel West calls it also, right? What is the impact of the period from the end of the 60s until now, the new Jim Crow, right, as Michelle Alexander calls it, right? Mm-hmm. What is the impact of that on the present? The racial wealth gap or the lineage wealth gap is the best way to measure that. And what we see is scary, and we know that, you know, Black folks know that we don't have a lot of wealth, but I don't know if Black folks know that a household right now, had, you know, here in Sacramento, somewhere else in California, somewhere else across the country, a household, Black household headed by two parents, both college educated, has about half of the wealth, if not less, probably about a third of the wealth as a white household where the head of the household is unemployed.
Okay? So you're saying a college educated two parent Black household holds half of the amount of wealth than a white family uneducated? Is that
where the head of the household dropped out of high school?
Head of household dropped out.
Out of high school. All right.
So we're saying that education has, so the in that comparison, you're saying that it's definitely not the education, because the white household has a college or a school dropout head of the household, but they still have more wealth than the family who crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's and did things according to, quote unquote, the American way. Two parents, husband, wife, 2.5 kids, picket fence, college grads, but still less well.
About a third of the wealth. Let's take it another step further. Take that same Black household where there's a college education, there's two parents, both of those parents are employed. The most recent data we have, the most recent information we can see, tells us that Black family has about a third or so of the wealth of a white family where the head of the household is unemployed. All right. So the point is, and we can keep going, right? The point is, we are not going to educate ourselves out of this. Go to school. Right. Pursue your educational dreams. You know, become the best at whatever you want to be. But that's not going to close the racial wealth gap for our people.
So you're bringing up because the question, the elephant in the room, is how does that happen? And you're getting to that point. How does that happen where we have this educated Black two-parent household family that cross the T's, dot the I's, still has half the wealth? And Chris, you're getting there. Kim, you were going to say something?
Well, I was going to say, you know, higher education is almost making it worse with all of the debt that you have once you graduate from school. So if you're not getting those higher paying jobs, even though you have the degree under your belt, I mean, that just saddles you with debt, which is going to prevent you from buying a home or anything like that. So it seems like we are hustling backwards. We're doing worse than we were in the 1960s and during the time of civil rights, when there were affirmative action programs that were specific to us, that were co-opted by other groups and including other groups that we just didn't benefit from. So we're definitely hustling backward in that regard.
So Chris, would you like to add to that as well? Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, let's talk about it. So, you know, like I said, we can go on and on in terms of the wealth picture. I think Black folks already know where we're going.
Let's break down that family example that you looked at, because Kim just opened up a nice little can of worms. So you got this picture perfect family, but when you look at the financials and how the breakdown of everything, they've graduated college, but they're straddled with student loan debt. Are they renting or are they owning? You know, if they're both working, who's taking care of the kids? Where are the kids going to school at?
Right.
Why are the kids going to the school that they're going to? Right. All of these are factors, right?
These are absolutely factors. And the but there are other factors too, and this is why we want to make the what I call the long case here, right? And this is why we are pointing to the racial wealth gap and really trying to use it as a way to connect the past and the legacy of slavery to the present, right? The answer to the question, quite simply, about why that this family that we're looking at right now, even though they went to school, they're working, they got two parents in the house, mm-hmm. they're doing everything they're supposed to do. The reason why this family is still going to be generationally disadvantaged compared to other families is because this family lives within, lives and has within it the legacy and the disadvantage of slavery accrued and accumulated over many, many, many generations, right? What does that look like in practice? What it looks like in the real world is this white family is getting generational wealth transfers from their parents, from their grandparents, from their great-grandparents, and this black family is not. And in many cases, the wealth is going the other way, right? This family is supporting, right? You know, friends, family, parents, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, we talk about generational wealth transfers a lot in terms of like when people die, but really it's more about
when you brought up the generational wealth transfer, it immediately made me think, okay, so now I know. So this white family who doesn't have this graduate, this degree, more than likely has parents or family members who have deep pockets in the form of either insurance or mortgage equity, or if they were to pass on, that they're going to inherit some kind of inheritance. Whereas yeah. with a black family, that is usually not the case.
That's not the case at all. And this is what we call, right, what they call an in vitro transfer, right? It's a transfer when the people are alive, right?
Right. So if that person wanted to buy a home, they probably, that the white person could go and get the money from a family member, mom or dad. Whereas the black family is not going to have that flexibility or the means to be able to do that. More than likely, they're going to have to take advantage of down payment assistance programs if they qualify.
Exactly. And you were on our show the other week, Key, and Chris raised a really good point of which comes first, the home ownership or the wealth. And, you know, I've been, you know, thinking about that. And actually, it's kind of reversed nowadays from when it was back in the day. You know, houses were $8,000, $11,000. You buy a house and then you were able to build some generational wealth off of that. During that time, we were locked out. We were locked out through redlining and through GI bills, not receiving the proper subsidies and assistance. So we were locked out at the time when buying a house could help you build wealth. And now to buy a house, you already have to have wealth or some type of inheritance is what you guys were talking about.
Right. And to that point, if we think about home ownership and how Kim was saying, you know, we were locked out at those times, let's go to the time in history. If we actually go to that time in history where there was the GI Bill, there, and this was another missed opportunity for the U.S. to make atonement. The GI Bill, through white and black Americans, they both fought in World War II. Black vets couldn't redeem their post-war benefits like their white peers. The GI Bill was mandated federally, but it was implemented locally. And the presence of racial housing covenants and redlining, as Kim alluded to, among local municipalities prohibited blacks from utilizing federal benefits. White soldiers were afforded the opportunity to build wealth by sending themselves and their children to college and by obtaining housing and small business grants. If we look at that time period, if we look at when that occurred, that was in the 40s, right? And so houses back then, Kim, did you say $8,000 something? You know, some ridiculously low amount at that time.
At that time. Right.
At that time.
To put it in context, my parents bought their home for $30,000 in 1970, which was 50 years ago. That property now would sell for somewhere like $300,000-$400,000. So.
And so you're making my point, which is it would not be until 20 years later that the Fair Housing Act was implemented that made redlining, blockbusting, and the other things that were happening preventing Blacks from getting into housing illegal. How much can an investment grow in 20 years? That $8,000 house that was purchased back then now is worth over $100,000 20 years later. That's the wealth disparity that we're talking about. If you shut a people out for 20 years from being able to make this kind of money, think about this. This is equivalent to what's happening right now in the stock market. Those of you who didn't know about Doge or Bitcoin 5-7 years ago, don't you kind of wish you had, if you had a crystal ball? You know, so if, let's say, for example, if we all did know about Doge and Bitcoin 20 years ago, not 20 years ago, when was it, like 7-8 years ago, right? If we all knew about it, but then we said only this group of people can make the investment. You can't. And then fast forward to today. How many headlines are we seeing in the news of overnight millionaires being created through Bitcoin and cryptocurrency, right? Yeah. But remember, we shut out that other group. So now there's people, now we say, okay, well, we're going to create a law now where you can actually buy. Well, you've missed out.
Yeah.
On a boatload of potential income, assets, the ability to gain wealth.
Keith.
That's what happened.
Hey, Keith, sorry, I wanted to just, one, co-sign everything you're saying right there. And this is exactly the point that is made. And I referenced this when you did our show. This is the point that Ira Katznelson made, right? And when affirmative action was white, right? Mm-hmm. Every time you denied us something and gave the advantage to the white folks, that was white affirmative action, right?
Right.
So that's happened like every day for like 400 years, yeah. Right? I mean, right? Like every time you denied us the opportunity and advantaged the white folks, that became white affirmative action. Then that's one point to make. The second point is, You are absolutely right that there was legal changes, but there was no what we call corrective or reparative justice, mm-hmm. right? If you stole stuff from us, you got to give it back.
Right.
Yeah. If you stole wealth from us and that includes opportunities, wealth, right? If you stole wealth and opportunities from us, that has to come back, right? You, it's not enough to just say, okay, the playing field is level. We're looking to get our stuff back,
right.
And that includes our wealth.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up. So when we say that there are laws that are created that no longer allow these things to be legal, and, you know, again, we stated earlier, just because there's a law doesn't mean that there aren't people that are still out there who are in positions of power, who are preventing these things from moving forward. And I've said on this show, you know, a few times, home ownership, it's so important that we get more Blacks into the real estate industry, not just as agents, but in the escrow, in the fields of escrow, in the fields of home inspections, appraisals, all of those areas. Brokers, we need more Black brokers. We need, and why? Because when you are in these positions of authority, these individuals were the gatekeepers in their day. They were the ones who stood in front and perpetuated the blockbusting and the redlining. And so we need to make sure that we are doing our part to promote the entrance into these and into this industry of African Americans, because we need to be able to influence the decision makers who are the homeowners. And so we need us in there. So I say that to say that these are the people who are the decision makers. We need more Blacks as police officers, as chief of polices. We need more of us. We need more Blacks as congressmen and women in different in education, teachers. Oh my God, do we need more Black teachers, especially in neighborhoods where there are more Black and brown little girls and boys, because we come from a different experience. And when we're dealing with our kids, the experiences that we have in our homes are different, like it or not. It's different from in other, and not just white homes, cultures, period. Every culture is a culture for a reason. It means that there are different experiences happening. And so if we're going to move around and try to create wealth and try to create gains specifically for Blacks, then these are some of the steps that we need to take, being in these positions. And also with the, how Chris was saying, give us our stuff back. It is the right thing to do. You took it, and now you need to give it back. And this is not a show to try to divide the lines. I saw there was a congressman who, I think he was the governor of some state, the specifics elude me right now, but he did not go along with an idea to, it was about teaching about, gosh, I wish I had it at the, it's on the tip of my tongue.
Critical race theory.
Yes. And he did not go along with it. And his comment, and it sounds good when you hear it, he says, you know, where we just came from, our nation is so divided right now, we don't need to be moving towards dividing it even further. Doesn't that sound great? That sounds good. But that is not what race theory is talking about. It's saying, you need to have a really clear understanding of what happened here. And I think for so long as a country, we have been conditioned that Black people are just the bottom of the barrel. Even there are Black people that are conditioned that we are the bottom of the barrel.
That and the fact that even when we do try, even when we do think it's the 100th year of the Tulsa massacre right now, we've built things and they were taken away or destroyed. We've gone to school for the education. Even if you do get your foot in the door, Black people tend to remain in those entry level positions and not really gaining the leadership roles. So you still have to depend, you know, on the powers that be to, right, to elevate you, even when you do get the education and experience.
Let's dive more into that, because that is something that I am so passionate about. And that is about us owning our own businesses and being the, because that's where we come from. We are creators, we are builders. If it were not for slavery, America would not be the economic powerhouse that it is today. Cotton, sugar, tobacco. Who do you think was behind the inventions that got that those things churning? Who's behind cultivating it and making it happen? Who was behind that? Black people. We're going to take a break, but when we come back, we're going to talk about that. You're listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. I'm Agent Key, and we'll be right back. Thank you guys so much. I'm sorry, I had to, I jumped in because I'm sorry.
No, that's great. That's great. So making a lot of valid points.
Yeah, when we come back from the break, Kim, I want you to talk a little bit more about business ownership, because the point you're making, I think a lot of, and I think it was Chris that said at some point, so it's almost like with each generation, we respond to what's happening to us differently based on where we came from. So like our grandparents were dealing with straight up, you know, coming out of slavery. And so they respond to white people differently. They respond to white interaction differently. Their children, our parents, respond differently. So my parents, they were around, you know, when segregation was high or growing up during times of segregation. So depending on where in the United States you grew up, you might have been directly in it if you were still down south. In California, it was more coveted. They were there, but it was sneaky. And you couldn't really, you know,
And still is, and still is, not was, still is.
Absolutely right. And with us today, with us, I shouldn't say today, when we were growing up, we were fighting against it. You know, that's where we kind of came out of the Black Panther, you know, then they dropped drugs in our communities, but we converted, you know, I'm saying converted because from the gang movement out of that, I think also came some courage and boldness. Because we have individuals like Ice Cube and Snoop Dogg, you know, they're talking about real experiences happening in our neighborhood, giving us the courage, speaking, you know, the rap music became a voice for us. Would you say that?
Oh, yeah.
I would say that, and I would say that a lot of the courage was, you know, stripped because our leaders were assassinated. So people were like, you know, even with what I do now, I've only been doing this for like about a year. Chris, you know, has taught me everything I need. I know about this political advocacy, and I'm like, why didn't I learn this 30 years ago? And they're like, if you were talking the way you're talking 30 years ago, you would have been, you know, hanging from a tree somewhere.
Right. And so that's what I mean. I think that the voice has been growing stronger and stronger and stronger with each generation. And so much so now there are white people in the front leading the charge on a lot of this. Because why? Because now they see, it's like, wait a minute, this is wrong. These are real injustices. And so, we're coming back. I'm sorry. Time is going to go fast. Okay, y'all. We got 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
You're back. We're back. You're listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. Talking during the break. And, you know, we're talking about some good stuff during the break. We want to make sure we get that information here on the show. Before we went to break, Kim brought up a very good point. That sometimes we get into jobs and we feel we hit a ceiling because those who are our superiors have the control and the ability to keep us from reaching higher heights. Kim, do you want to talk about that a little bit more?
Well, exactly what you said. And I do see more of a movement and a push towards entrepreneurship with younger Black people because, you know, they've seen their parents face those barriers and hit those ceilings and not be able. I just opened a business myself because I've been having difficulty, you know, breaking down barriers, even though I'm further along in my career. So, yes, having your own business is very important, but it's like, you should have told me this 30 years ago. I would have been, you know, I would have known that I wasn't going to be able to break these barriers. I mean, we need to have an honest conversation about it because just telling Black people that they're not experienced, they're not good enough, they're not educated enough, that stick is up. We know what we've done. We have the experience. We have the education, but they're using that same old, you know, playbook of, you know, you're just not experienced.
Right. And I think it's wonderful that we've come, we are having those conversations now. And thank God for social media and the invention of, you know, the cell phone and the internet and all of those things, because now we can have those conversations, control that narrative, and many more of our children, the next generation, they are all about entrepreneurship.
Right. But even when you do start the business, you need to get access to capital. And that's still an issue when you're dealing with these systemic, you know, banking institutions and whatnot. So.
But these are things now that I believe I'm very excited about the next generation, because these are conversations that we can have very quickly now because of the internet, you know. You turn on, you get a prominent person speaking about it, just like, you know, on the show today, we have you guys on the show speaking about it, and you're touching a lot of people in 1 hour about this topic versus 30 years ago, this show wasn't happening and definitely not about this topic. And 30 years ago, it was all about you need to go to school, go to college, get married, graduate, have 2.5 kids, work for the man for 30, 40, 50 years, and then retire. That was the goal. And that was right for them back then because that's all they knew, right?
Right. And that just doesn't work anymore either because there's no job security. There's no loyalty. There's no working for a company until you retire and having a nice pension. I mean, I've even said like, you know, pensions are for white people because they're the ones that are getting all those jobs that grant you a pension and a retirement and CalPERS and everything that goes along with it. So.
Well, and the other thing, too, and like I said before, I want to be very clear. This is not a show that's intending to divide. We're not trying to divide. We want to educate. So on this show, when we say the term white person or white or black, we're trying to distinguish what really happened. And we can't move forward by tiptoeing around the tulips when we have conversations like this. This is what happened. White people did this to black people. But by the same token, white people now are coming to the defense and aid of black people based on the things that America did to blacks decades and centuries ago. So we do want to give, we can't move forward without them. We can't.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of people who are white who are helping make this come true. So can we just say that?
We can say that. To be honest with you, I want to, we can take it a step further, right? In the reparations work that we do here on the ground, right? And the work that we've done supporting, obviously, you know, the passage of California's reparations task force, which by the way, starts in 2 weeks, fam, right? Is legally required to start in 2 weeks. Okay, we'll see, you know, if we stick to that, but on June 1st, right? But to your point, our claim is against our government.
Right. That's great.
Okay.
That's great. I point that out.
Very often, whenever I start talking about reparations around some white people, what I'll hear is, I didn't do anything,
right,
and I don't feel like I have to pay. And I say to them, you didn't do anything. You don't have to pay anything because my claim is not against you, and it's not against white people. It's against the government that legalized, supported, enabled, facilitated, did it, right?
Yeah.
And so you know, white folks, not white folks. That's not black. We need you in this fight. We need you to win this,
yeah,
right? And this claim is against the United States government, our government, and also you know state governments, corporations, et cetera, et cetera.
Chris, we've got to have you and Kim back after June 1st to give us an update. We are at the end of our time, but we definitely want to bring you back so that we can catch up with you and see where this has gone, how this has transpired. Thank you both so much for being on the show today. And we're looking forward to seeing what else that you continue to do. We are all one body, and the work that you're doing as a part of the body is definitely needed. And we appreciate you very much. Thank you. And everyone, you are listening to 97.5 FM KDEE. I am Agent Key. And remember, if you are doing what you were created to do, I will see you at the top.
Thanks, Key.
Thank you both so much for taking the time. I appreciate it. And thank you, Chris, for having your little icon pop on the screen so people can see.
No worries.
There were three people that were working it out.
That was so much fun.
You're welcome. And I definitely want to have you both come back after the June 1st to give us an update. So I'm going to reach out to you for what do you think would be a good time to come back, July, so we can see what kind of progress or the fall?
Sooner the better, probably. Mm-hmm. So I would say if not around Juneteenth, then early July.
That would be a good time around the Juneteenth. So I'm actually going to be, there's a Wednesday that I won't be here in June. I'll be back How about June 16th?
Oh, that works for me.
That sounds good. Then we could talk about some of our Juneteenth activity, recruitment activities. And with my producer's hat on, it still says we're live. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's listening. Let me end the broadcast. Let me see if that's going to take you out. If it ends, just stay right there, Kim. I'm going to come back, okay?